Absolutely delighted to have you here this afternoon, and thank you for joining. We've had a fantastic turnout. We actually have over 500 people who've registered for the event. I believe that it's been popular because clearly you're passionate about it. We're all passionate about it. But I think the topic, the title of the event, ESG Unravelled, has really piqued everyone's interest. And quite rightly so, because you know, we all have been listening to what's going on with ESG. There are a lot of acronyms, there's a lot of waffle, and what that's exactly what we wanted to cut through. So the format for this afternoon is very simple. So we have six panelists, the reason we have six, that's quite a lot of people. I felt it's really, really important that we have different perspectives on what's happening within ESG. And so consequently, I felt that it's essential that we hear it and are able to pick the panelists' brain, so to speak, understand what they're seeing out there. And just before we go into the panelists, and they're going to talk for about 2 minutes each, and then we'll go straight into a Q&A session, which is me asking the panelists question. And then we want to leave ample time at the end for you, the audience, to ask questions. And so I think that's really important. So please do start asking questions. You can type them in clearly. I think you all know the format now, where we've been used to it for a year or so. Very briefly, my background is capital markets and private equity. And then now I'm building a fintech platform, specifically wealth tech. And part of the objective is to ensure that the users who are family offices and high net worth individuals can rotate their portfolios to become more ESG compliant. And that's been a challenge in itself because of data, and we'll talk about that on this call. It's interesting because I went back in time, so to speak, to about 7 years ago. So I was presenting for the first time on ESG. And I was presenting in a rather stuffy Mayfair members club, and the audience was basically a group of fund managers. And I brought up the topic of greenwashing, and people looked at me aghast, as if to say, you know, oh, the sheer temerity of this chap to bring this topic up. And the reason I've just mentioned this is because it's rather sad that greenwashing is still prevalent out there. And in 7 years, you know, we've moved forward, so please don't think we haven't progressed. But the reality is that there are oceans of greenwashing out there, and that's really what we want to break down as well. On to the panelists, I am absolutely delighted to introduce an esteemed group, and they're going to give you a quick overview. So let's just jump straight into it. So firstly, over to you, Olga.
Yes, thank you very much, Bobby. Hello, everybody. Thank you for joining our webinar. My name is Olga Visokova. So by my surname, you can guess that I'm Russian originally, but I live and work in London. I'm a co-founder of Global Next Gen Community, which we started together with Vahi Vartanyan, for the family office, family business members, the next gens. And our mission is to educate them. And why do I speak today here? Because next gen will inherit by the end of this decade up to $45 trillion. So they will be the wealthiest generation in history. And thus they will be the biggest and the most powerful investors in history. Therefore, it's important to teach them today about the importance of impact, sustainability, and to put their minds into that direction. My personal path to sustainability came from my family, from our family business in Russia, which is in financial sector, and with our main shareholders being European Bank for Reconstruction and Development and German Development Bank. And with their support, we have established the sustainable business model 10 years ago. Back then in Russia, nobody spoke about sustainability. They just started speaking last year, actually. So it's a big way ahead, and we are the pioneers of sustainability. So I'm, in my mind and in my heart, I'm a big advocate of sustainable banking, sustainable finance and investment.
Thanks, Olga. I'm Angus Forbes. Hi, everybody. My history is in the city. I was in the city for 20 years at James Capel, Merrill Lynch on the sell side, and then at GLG Partners on the buy side, where I ran a consumer equity, a long short fund. I left the city in 2007. My passion has been the environment for a long time. I started recycling on the Merrill Lynch floor back in the mid 90s. Launched a green fund at GLG, launched a fund management firm called Natural Capital Funds Management in Sydney, Bankers Without Boundaries, a not-for-profit. And my passion these days is I advocate global governance of the biosphere, which is a bit out there for today. I'm hoping that I can add some value to you today by perhaps being a bit of a historian on ESG and where I think it's going to go for the next 30 years. I think we've left the pioneering stage, that's the last 20 years. I think we're now in the necessity stage, and then we'll be moving on to the maturity stage from 2030 to 2050. So I'm really looking forward to today's panel. Thank you.
Thanks very much. And then Darcy, moving on to you.
Thank you, and welcome everyone to this fantastic hour in the middle of the day discussing everything impact and sustainability. I am Darshita Gillis. I am originally Gillis. From my surname, you cannot guess I'm Indian, but I am. I married a Scotsman, so I have the mixed name. I am originally from Mumbai. I started my journey as a chartered accountant, as a banker. And I'm one of those few bankers who says that banking didn't take my soul away. I actually enjoyed banking. I loved every minute of my work. And at the same time, I knew I wanted to stretch beyond banking. And that led me into very similar realms as what Angus described, global systems change, and how do we really bring organizations, governments, businesses, nonprofits, to really collaborate for the impact we want to have globally. And with that in mind, I founded Munch, which is an impact platform. The world doesn't need another impact platform. What the world really needs is an interoperable system that allows for all these disparate data sets to come together. And that's really at the heart of what we do. We provide intelligence and insights, we provide dashboards, and we provide networks, but the idea is to really give impact-related needs, meet the impact-related needs of all the stakeholders in this larger impact ecosystem. And I'm in the ESG space, we have launched solutions for corporates and investors, specifically to streamline ESG, to bring their stewardship commitments into a data tracking system and automate it. And what I really look forward to in this afternoon session today is to share all the key learnings, the key challenges, the loopholes, and concerns I have about the way we're going about ESG, and just bring it to bear. So looking forward.
Thank you very much. Sorry, Darcy, I'm going to have to cut you short. Thank you. And Paul, over to you.
Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the call. My name's Paul Young. I work with Grant Thornton. I've been with Grant Thornton now just on 9 years. I work within the financial services group, and I lead on finance risk and compliance. And as part of that business profile, I also lead on our ESG offering across the market. Now, my previous history to Grant Thornton was working at some large international banks, both in finance and risk management, organizations like JP Morgan, Bank of America, and Barclays. And now I provide advisory and assurance services across the entire financial services sector, which covers investment management, banking, insurance, etc. From an ESG perspective, I would say about 2 years ago, you're probably all aware that the subject started to hit the media in a much more intense fashion through a combination of governments, regulators, even central banks, all setting out their platform on managing, in particular, climate change, but the broader ESG program. So we have clients that come to us who are asking for advice on how to actually implement an entire ESG framework within their organizations. So that falls to the type of skill sets and offerings that we provide, which covers governance, risk management, disclosure type information.
Ketan, over to you. And I mentioned the word passionate. And what I think really comes out when you're talking to a fund manager is how passionate are they about the actual topic? And Ketan has that in spades. So Ketan, over to you.
Yeah, hi guys. My name is Ketan Patel. I'm a fund manager at Eden Tree Investment Management. We've been pioneers in ESG in the UK. We launched our first fund in 1988. I've been with the firm for close to 20 years, solely focusing on ESG investments, primarily UK multi-cap and global equity income. When I joined the firm, we spoke about ethics, and now the language has moved on to RI, SRI, ESG, impact, transition, and sustainability. We at Eden Tree run a suite of responsible and sustainable funds focusing on long-term outperformance. We're active fund managers. We believe that's the way that you should manage your money in this space. When I started, the focus in ESG was very much, would ESG outperform? I.e., did you have to give up some performance for your values? And also that the actual universe was limited and therefore it was higher risk. Well, those two myths have now been comprehensively kind of busted. I guess the challenge now for ESG is very much what Bobby said earlier, is to battle the greenwash now. And we are hopefully in the second generation or second iteration of ESG. So back to
Great.
You, Bobby.
Thank you very much. And we save the best to last. Sandy Kumar, Global Head of Grant Thornton FSG, and at this point we should thank Grant Thornton for all of the pulling together of this event and the team, and I'll thank him formally at the end. But Sandy, over to you.
Thank you. Firstly, I want to thank everybody for One FS Wealth for partnering with us on this event, and a great panelist group here as well. So delighted to be working with you all. My name is Sandy Kumar. I'm a partner within Grant Thornton. I head up the financial services group for the firm globally. Delighted to be talking about such an important area, and I'm conscious of the time and rather get into the discussion. But the key salient things we've been seeing is that I think ESG is on the forefront of every client. You know, it really is now, you know, is more than just simply a score. It is something fundamental that every business needs to think about. And if done correctly, it creates an advantage for you. COVID-19 has accelerated the ESG agenda for all firms. I think that's something to be very mindful of. And what we are seeing from clients, hopefully we'll touch through some of that. But I think most of the clients, as Paul also touched on, are asking for us to help them actually, firstly, to educate, you know, all of the various taxonomy that it sits outside and how they actually deploy the various requirements that are out there. And we hope through this panel that you will get some of that learning, and I'm delighted to be part of that. So over to you, Bobby. We'll begin with that one.
Great. Thank you. Okay, so let's get straight into it. So I've got a bit of a hand grenade to throw in here first. And this one is really to everyone. We're not going to go around the whole panel with every question. But this one is actually something which was a quote by a chap called Chamath, and I don't know if you've actually come across him, but it's Chamath Palihapitiya, and he has his view, and he's quite an influential chap now. He's saying that ESG investing is a complete fraud. What do you all think about that? Now, clearly, we know what the answer is going to be, but what do you think about people coming out with that? And before I let you answer, the other thing is that with other influential people, and this isn't a sort of beat the billionaire up session, but there was another quote about a plutocrat out there who was being inconvenienced off the back of a fishing trip, and there wasn't enough water in the lake. And I think we all know what who we're referring to. But just with respect to those comments, can I ask you, Angus, first, what do you think of that?
I think with Chamel, he having made his money in the Facebook, in the social pillar, if you've made all your money in the social pillar like he has, which is, you know, where, you know, the founders of Facebook and people like that, like Zuckerberg, felt so strongly that they were on mission, that it was a huge social purpose that they were undertaking to the connectivity of humanity. That when you look then at the other new players coming into ESG, you're saying, hey, you're the second runners. You know, we did everything for humanity and connectivity. And I think Elon Musk probably feels that the same way with his environmental pillar. So it's easy when you've delved in deep, like Shamil has over the last 10 years to say that, but it really isn't relevant. The huge broader movement of ESG will ultimately be more powerful and more effective.
Yeah, no, thank you. Darshi, what do you think? And if you could please keep your responses pithy. I've got lots of questions to ask you all.
Very happy to keep it pithy. Speaking to greenwashing and ESG, I definitely think there is an element of ESG not necessarily delivering what we are looking for it to deliver, because in essence, ESG is really a risk framework or a risk management framework. Let's say, hypothetically speaking, all the companies, all our investments, 100% ESG positive risk on ES and G. Will we have solved climate crisis? Will we have more? Will our challenges be solved? I'm not sure. So I think ESG is a step in the right direction, but it is not the solution. So I would encourage the industry that they stretch beyond and look at impact, look at additionality, materiality, intentionality, as well as measurability. Thank you.
Thank you. Paul, what do you think?
I would agree with Darshita. So the issue at the moment, given the amount of governments and regulators jumping on the back of the ESG and forcing the market to react very quickly, there is actually a bit of a bubble that's been created in certain investments. So the thing that I would like to sort of tease out in this call is the amount of due diligence that you really need if you're reshaping your portfolio. Because there's a wall of money coming to ESG investments, but there aren't enough investments globally to actually absorb all of that money. And so when you get these government and regulator impacts forcing the market in a certain direction, you always get a bubble that appears until the market can catch up with that wall of money. So I do think that if you looked at it from that perspective, there is the potential to say it's a fraud, but it's more about how you analyze the investments that that you want to put your money towards.
Yeah, thank you. Olga, over to you.
Yeah, thank you. I think that this bubble can be explained because the goals were clearly set by United Nations, 17 sustainable goals. And according to this, $2.5 trillion should be invested annually into sustainable sectors globally. So the money is rushing into it, but most of this money is just labeled with sustainable name. So it's estimated, the sustainable investment sector is estimated at $4 trillion today, but we are still very far away from reaching the sustained SDG. So why is that? Because only $700 billion are really new funds raised in the markets for the ESG companies. So then we have to divide sustainable sector, which is raising new funds, and sustainable sector, which is just traded on the stock exchanges like ETFs, iShares and shares, which is also good, but it's not a new money raised by the companies and invested into impact, which you can quantify and measure.
Yeah, sure. Thank you. Sandy?
I think I principally agree with everybody there. I think the importance of each of the components in terms of, you know, community inclusiveness, you know, and the structural side are fundamental in what happens. I think this is a very much a necessary in thinking and how, you know, we go forward in our society. And I think, you know, to call it a sham in some way, I think is an appropriate word. And I think it's important. I think we recognize what we are trying to do with ESG and what it's trying to do to society and the important role it's playing. It's lifting our thinking to a different level. The contribution it can make in some small way of making society better. And I think it's fundamental. We all play an important role within that. Whether that's 100% right today or not, it's not quite, you know, it's to be designed, but there's a lot of room for people to accept that there is a need for a change, a more accelerated process in that. And I think COVID has very much highlighted the need for the better firms to be more agile in their thinking and to think about what they do going forward, you know, from all aspects, ethical, you know, their people, you know, the chain that they work in terms of supplier customer base. And I think it's really important that we have that thinking going on all the time. I think it's an important, very, very important topic.
Yeah, thank you. Ketan, over to you.
He's wrong and time will prove him wrong. As simple as that.
That's good. Very emphatic, and I completely agree with that. And well said, all of you. So, okay, Olga, over to you. So we wanted to hear from you about next gens. We keep on hearing about the next gens wanting to rotate their portfolios. They're far more cognizant of what's happening with respect to climate change, etc. What's your feedback been? And if you can, again, keep it pithy because of time. And if you can maybe focus on what practical experiences have you had, and maybe flag the numerous dialogues that you've had with NextGens off the back of your positioning.
Yes, thank you. It's a very good question, because there are a lot of problems that NextGen experience in this field. So they have a lot of passion, this word which we are using a lot today, but practically they can't do much. And why is that? Because according to them, so we had a lot of webinars with them, and then we asked for the feedback. The first problem which was mentioned is the lack of independent advisors. So somebody who can really tell them what's impact, where they will make a difference, and not just sell them, not just another private bank selling them their fund or their portfolio. So independent advisor, first of all. Secondly, having clarity on personal values, which will drive the investment strategy of the whole family and the family office. And also coming with that, the alignment of the mindset of the family, because normally patriarchs do not want to hear about these so-called new trends, which is actually mainstream today. But so there is kind of an antagonism within the families in investment, also which is based on stereotype that they have to compromise on the return for this emotional return, which is not true. And of course, there is a big baggage of family offices problems like tax, legal structuring, and normally the advisors, again, the bottleneck is advisors who say no to the next gens for this kind of investment.
Thank you, very well put. Okay, so next question is really about funds and what's actually happening within that fund arena. With, for example, Aviva saying that they are pulling out of all companies or taking risk off to all companies that have any sort of fossil fuel type angles and positioning. So this is for Ketan and for Paul. What are you seeing out there? So to Ketan first.
Yeah, thanks. It's a good question. So when you get a large firm like Aviva or BlackRock and they're saying that they may pull out potentially, that they're actually conflicted because they're on money that is screened and unscreened. If you go to a specialist fund manager like EdenTree, and there's a lot more out there now, we only do ESG funds. So we have no conflict. None of our institutional money, none of our retail, none of our client money, charity, etc. has any oil or mining or stuff that we would consider not to be suitable for the next 20, 30 years or is damaging the planet. So I think you should take statements by Aviva, BlackRock on this kind of stuff extremely lightly. Most of them don't even vote their proxies. You know, there's a reason why companies get away with this poor behavior. We at EdenTree vote all proxies in-house by the FM, run by the RI team led by my colleague Neville White. So it's important to go and say specialist, active fund manager. And also what Olga said, you need to get clear advice as well.
Yeah, sure. Thank you. And then Paul, and specifically in the context of what are you seeing? I know you have been working on a lot of mandates from fund managers, going through that due diligence loop, which has been clearly enlightening from your perspective, I'm sure. So please.
Well, the thing that they're most concerned with at the moment is the amount of regulation that they actually have to abide by over this year and then into next, particularly with disclosures. Now, the interesting thing there is, you know, as we said, you can still have funds that are not necessarily, when you look through them, through, you know, second and third order impacts on the underlying investments, you can still have a fund that they call green, which when you look through them are not necessarily green. But given that the regulatory disclosures now are being forced across the industry and quite widely, and particularly now that US seems to be have bought back into the whole climate agenda, those disclosures over a period of time are going to force entities to be very public about the shapes of their portfolios. So I think it's not going to happen tomorrow, but it's going to happen over the next 4 to 5 years. Of bringing a level playing field and much more transparency on the shape of those portfolios.
Sure, that's good. That's great, thank you. And then let's talk a bit about data. By the way, after a question, if you have a point that you want to make and you can make it in a few sentences, then please go ahead. I'm conscious that there's a bit of a time between each of you being able to speak, and I know you're keen to share your thoughts. So let's talk about data. Darshi, if you can just maybe go through, what are your thoughts on data? This is actually to Darshi and to Sandy as well. So Darshi, if you can go first, you know, everyone's confused with all of the data sets, and you know, with the recent news with what's happening with SASB and other data sets which purport to be useful, but actually in reality turn out to be less than useful out there. So please.
Thank you. I think we are at the beginning stages of making or going towards something that's really works. So I always say the process of cleaning up is messy. And I think that's what's happening with the whole sector. I think there are some incredible data sources or question banks that have been created, which are really metric driven and incisive and go to the heart of the issue. And the challenge in the data space is not that there are not enough data capture systems. The challenge is that the investors are collecting data in one form and the companies are filling those in another. And the companies don't have a sense of how their data is meeting with the investors and on what basis investors are making decisions. So the real challenge is really bringing these two ecosystem players, who are really the key players in the ESG space, into a unified way. I think the point about regulations and the new requirements coming in, there are quite a few ungraspable areas, but I feel these are challenges that will even out over time.
Sure, thank you. Sandy?
Yeah, no, absolutely right. So I think the regulator is laying markers of what they expect in terms of reporting. I think there's a lot of data out there. I think what we've seen is that the clients are asking us to help put a framework first of what they need to do. I think, you know, different things mean different, you know, the requirement means different for, you know, different client bases. And I think understanding that diversity is really quite important. Getting an understanding of what the board appetite is to make that improvement, how culturally you get all of that information right, is very important. We've been building out quite a big data team to support these areas. I think there is a exercise going on from our perspective of educating the broader market of what is actually being asked, and then what are the good practices of doing a snapshot, a review of where are you relative to that, and then assessing of what you, how you use data to produce ongoing monitoring and reporting, which allows you to take the regulatory box. I think the benchmark will improve more and more. The regulator will be a key driver, particularly in financial services, that's picked up. So if you're now linking the lenders with the investors, I think you've got a much more of a dynamic movement taking place there. And I think parameters and KPIs of that type will be driven by the regulator, which I think businesses need to think about.
Thank you. Any general points on data in a couple of sentences for those who haven't answered that? I think that the point's been well covered, and I think there needs to be clarity, and I think that's the word that we hear a lot. So Angus, over to you. I've got a question for you, which I think you're going to love, which is to do with your view on what the governments are doing in respect of ESG and impact. And I know you've been involved in this for a long while. Where do you think we've got to?
So certainly a date for your diaries is next year. 1972 was the universally signed Stockholm Declaration, signed by all 189 countries at that time. that said that the natural assets of the earth must be safeguarded. And next year is the 50-year anniversary of that declaration. And every monitor, every single one, from ozone to troposphere to rainforest to topsoil to oceans to fish, has worsened. And in 1979 was the Geneva Convention, which stated, again under the auspices of the UN, that climate change was a big problem. Now, in 1979, we had 336 parts per million of CO2. We're now at 417. So governments are on board more now than ever. President Xi made a big statement in September when he said that the combination of climate change and biophysical degradation was actually an existential risk to humanity. So the move is there, but we are, make no mistake, it's been 50 years that governments have been known about this and have attempted to move to no avail. And I'm afraid the forecasts for the next 30 years are not good.
Okay, thank you. We'll talk a bit more if we can on that topic, because I think it's fascinating to see how that leadership from the top is progressing. And with your GPA initiative, etc., I think that clearly everyone out there does feel that there needs to be some change, and we can talk about GPA at another time. Okay, so moving on to just a quick question on family offices. So Olga, for you, so why do you think if family offices are so positive about ESG and what they're doing with respect to it, why do you think that they still hold so many very poor quality investments and fund holdings in that respect?
Yeah, I think that the first answer would be that they are ill-advised and uneducated. As we discussed in the beginning, the investors should be educated in ESG to avoid being greenwashed, to avoid being sold something that is labeled sustainable and in core it's not. So the investors have to take time and do their own due diligence. This would be my recommendations for the investors. The times of quick, easy, large money has gone. Now we really have to be more curious to choose how we spend money as consumers or as investors as well. We have to take time to see how our actions impact the planet, because it's now or never, as Uncle said. 50 years we didn't do anything. We don't have 50 years more. We have to act now. And when there is money and education, then we can make a difference. If there is only money, there won't be any difference. So that's the problem of family offices. They need good advisors. They need good consultants who will come and help them to invest wisely. And also, as I said, they have to get rid of the stigma that they choose portfolios versus sustainability and impact investing. Also, the impact investments are longer, and sometimes they are confused with philanthropy, and it shouldn't be done so. Family offices do these mistakes very often. So it's I think it's just the mentality change which need to take place, and slowly it is happening with the help of next generation.
Yeah, sure. Darshi, any comments on that? I know that you've been involved in philanthropy and the family office world as well. Any quick comments on that?
I concur with Olga. I feel there's a need for just a really good knowledge base for family offices to really understand the new solutions that are being needed and the new options they already have. There are lots of solutions out there that can enable family offices. OneFS is one of them. But I really think it's the knowledge gap that's really that needs plugging in. And I would say intentionality is another. One is, you know, to push knowledge. The other is the real intention to serve clients in the journey they're on. And I think those two married together can really enable what we need. Thanks.
Yeah, sure. Thank you. And then this is really to the fund management side of things. So how do you go, and this is not specifically to Ketan, but everyone can answer. How do you go about selecting ESG investments, both at portfolio level and at fund level? And then how do you actually then report on that? And then Ketan, this is probably to you first, but Paul, I'd love to hear your thoughts on it. And then just generally, Angus, you've clearly got a fund manager background as well. So let's just hear a few comments on that. Ketan, you first, please.
Yeah, I think choosing the right fund manager is the key aspect. A fund manager who understands that you have to be an active manager, a bottom-up stock picker. Also, some of the language has changed from ethical ESG RI. So you have to be very clear in talking to the client, say exactly what do you want to achieve, because impact investing is very different from ESG investing or sustainability, etc. And then that's targeting what the client wants fundamentally and actually listening and then reflecting back. And at a company level, do you have to recognize that investors must be responsible and sustainable, because you often get companies that are very good at sustainability, but they're not actually run in a responsible manner. When we talk about E, S, and G, the G always gets missed out because it's the most boring, dull part. If the G is done correctly, if company management are aligned with shareholders, etc., and held to account, the S and the E will actually follow, but the G must be pivotal. And during the pandemic, the S has come to the forefront. We cannot stand by having people who are not paid minimum wage or labor rights not being done correctly whilst, you know, people are making billions and billions. Capitalism has to be responsible and sustainable, but the R must come first. If you get the R and the G aligned, you will achieve tremendous amounts of gains. And we are seeing the gains. You know, we've been doing this for well over 30 years. If you speak to my boss, Sue Rand, massive changes have come through, but we're now at that stage where we need to kick on now and take advantage of when this sector has become, you know, sexy, hot, whatever phrase do you want to use, but it has to have and grow and mature and show that it's got multiple facets. It's not just about saving the planet. It's actually the ESG, it's RI, sustainability, all those, you know, things have to unravel correctly and has to be done with the right partner. And I think education and the point Olga makes, you know, we need to educate people as well.
Yeah, and actually, just before I go to Paul, I mean, what's really interesting I found is that even smaller companies, i.e. startup companies, now need to put together a ESG policy document. And I think that's really smart. That needs to happen right from inception. And I'm actually surprised that more VC and angel investors don't actually ask for that. I think that should be mandatory. So as part of the data room, it should be in there. Why would it not be in there? Because you need to actually have that from grassroots level. Please, Kevin, finish off.
I was going to say, it does have to come from the top. If the CEO and the CFO don't get it, one of my colleagues, Neville, always asks a question when we go into a meeting, it's me and him. And one of the first questions he asks is, how many people have died this year on your watch? And often, you know, if the CEO is flummoxed, mate, you haven't got, you know, what's your health and safety? How many women do you employ? Do you understand about gender diversity, whether it's at the top or the bottom? If management don't get it, then you know you're in the presence of someone who does not care. And you either engage and tell them to change. If not, you need to disengage and find a better investment, because there's plenty of out there that you can.
Yeah, sure. And that's a really good point that you made at the end. And actually, just before I go to Paul, so Sandy, as a global leader, I mean, what's your view on that? And how do you run Grant Thornton from that perspective?
I think excellent point about culture and, you know, and the tone from the top. I think it stems from that. I think there has to be a real desire to give something up to gain something. So if you're talking about long-term business that is really contributing to society as a whole, you have to invest in it today, and you have to invest in many, many components of being inclusive, looking at your customer base, you're looking at your supply chain, you know, acting in an ethical manner at every step. You've got to look at, you know, the kind of technology you use, what resources do you use, what waste you put out, you know, how do you look at your whole business? And I think there is a whole cultural need about putting today's revenue level and profitability a little bit on a slower burn to achieve the longer term right thing for your business, but also for the community as a whole. Now, that these are tough choices. These are tough things, because you look at across the FTSE and the more broader group, you know, CEOs have a life of about 3 to 5 years at max. There's a rotation very fast. Everyone's working to a short timeline, and we're probably compressing that even more. So how do you get a board that is really thinking of a business longer term and really puts this at the top end of his agenda, and everybody else fits into it rather than driving the agenda, which is about today?
Yeah, thank you. Paul, and then actually, I think because we've gone into more of a general point, I mean, if everyone can answer this, so I'll come around to everyone in turn. So, Paul?
Just picking up on Ketan's point, I think when you're choosing an investment advisor or investment manager, it has to be you have to get a sense that they're not just playing lip service to advising on the portfolio. So using an example that I think maybe Ketan was referring to, last year you probably all saw the Boohoo hit the front page news, and it wasn't necessarily about Boohoo's strategy. It was actually in their supply chain. So what was happening was they were paying the supply chain, who was supplying them clothes for their retail operations, were paying below minimum wage. Now, interestingly, MSCI, who is a rating agency for ESG type issues, gave them an 8 out of 10 for their supply chain labor standards. Now, you look at what actually happened. Boohoo lost a third of their value when it all hit the news. If that was in your portfolio, you wouldn't be very happy. So there was a combination of issues there that MSCI wasn't necessarily looking through the organization to do a proper assessment. They were more taking anecdotal evidence to be able to give that score. Mm-hmm. So it is a difficult subject, but you do have to be diligent about the investment advice that you're receiving.
Yeah, thank you. And then Darshi, then Angus, then Olga, if you can comment. And you can comment on any aspect of that question, because it sort of morphed into a second point, which is about the ESG bit, which is still relevant. So Darshi, over to you. Any comments on that?
Yeah, thank you. I'd like to pick up on the data points that Paul mentioned and how sometimes the market can be skewed when data sets are not transparent or not necessarily deep enough. And sometimes we invest so much in big brands that we just take it for granted that if it is from a reputable source, it's good. And I think what the sector needs, or the whole ecosystem needs, is a streamlined system where data sources have a tag. Is this credible? Is this secondhand? Is this, you know, you might want to fact check, it's post-dated. And I think these kind of easily accessible, transparent data labels to data that matter when it comes to financial decision making is really key in ensuring that we have streamlined systems of how we allocate capital to ESG.
Yeah, thank you. Angus?
I'll probably go back to Sandy's point and also an intro probably to Olga. I mean, very soon, your shareholders, your employees, and everyone in your supply line are going to be global citizens. They're young, they know exactly what's going on, and they can see because they've got technology at their fingertips. So you've got to be right on the front edge, otherwise they'll walk away. So it's, you have to know what nanocellulose is, and that it is 7 times stronger than steel and 7 times lighter. You have to know every inch of your supply line. You have to be right on the front edge of ESG every minute for the next 30 years.
Yeah, thank you. Olga, over to you.
Thank you, Angus. Completely agree. I do believe that
you can't all agree. That's forbidden.
Oh, that was my opening speech. I do believe that greenwashing will be reduced, driven by the consumer's behavior, curiosity, and education. It will be very expensive for the companies to lie, because it will cost them the business, actually. And the consumers will never forgive this. Also, you can't become ESG or sustainable overnight. It's not that you just put a nice new tag and get a rating from the agency who do not, you know, fear anything. ESG has to be in a corporate culture, as we, as my colleagues spoke correctly. It has to come from the supervisory board, management board, to the employees who are dealing with the customers who are selling the products or services. So it has to be all through the corporation. And what it takes capital investment, capital allocation to ESG. It costs not cheap. ESG transformation is not cheap at all. That's why probably it takes such a long time. The companies prefer to do greenwashing because it's cheaper than becoming ESG. But I think the day has come when they don't have a choice anymore. They have to find the capital, they have to invest, and they have to become ESG. Otherwise, they will lose the markets, the clients, and then the business eventually.
Yeah, no, well said, and some great comments coming out there. We've got one more question, which is we have questions from the audience. We have a lot of questions. There's no way we can go through all of these, but I feel that we owe the audience some really pithy responses. So sorry to use that word again, but you're going to have to compress it yet further. Okay, so first question, let's do a rapid fire round, and then just for the audience's benefit, we're going to have a pearls of wisdom session at the very end. So each of the panelists will share a pearl of wisdom. So we've got literally a few minutes. We've got about 6 minutes left. One thing I've learned is that we probably need to make these sessions slightly longer. I found it fascinating, and hopefully the audience have as well. Okay, so let's go. So first rapid fire question. Views on technology and data. What are your views on technology and data in the context of ESG? Sandy first, but just two or three sentences, please, all of you.
Yeah. Fundamental. I think you need a good mechanism of collating that. And I think consistency of reporting and gathering that is really important. So good, you know, sensible source, and then making sure you're taking the wide stakeholder requirements to use that data effectively.
Thank you. Darshi?
I think two important points. One is the need to make sure that whatever data systems or technologies you use work for the other stakeholder. And second is allocation of budget, to Olga's point. Both organizations don't have a budget holder for data and technology when it comes to ESG or impact, or even a role holder. So I would say those would be like the key points to look for.
Yeah, thank you. Angus?
No comment.
Okay, Olga?
No, thank you.
Okay, that's great. Ketan?
I'd say it's important to have an in-house data source if you rely on external data. And in the case of Boohoo, the stock was held in 20 ESG funds, wasn't held in the funds that we run because we actually screened it and actually failed it. So having an in-house team like we have at Edentree, run by my colleague Neville White, we do our own work. We do use external data sources, but we actually question it. And most of the time, the data gatherers aren't of the highest quality because they don't often meet with companies or management. We at Edentree meet with 700 companies a year. So I would say own your own data if you can, and don't rely on it on solely on external.
Yeah, good
point. Question, Ketan. Just a quick one. Ketan, the information you hold is so important. How does that information percolate through the industry? Because no point in everyone doing what you...
No. I agree totally. It's a very expensive way of building a business, but we're fully committed to ESG and have been for over 30 years, and that's what makes us different fundamentally. And it's very hard. We're not going to try and make any money out of it to kind of monetize it because we think it's wrong. We don't even charge for it. So when you come to us as clients, you get it free. You know, so we charge the same. And I know there's a lot of pressure on fee, but we don't charge for it. So for us, it's our USP fundamentally.
Right, that's great. Ketan, I'll be knocking on your door for some data after this, for sure. Okay, so next one, very quickly, because we are getting to this pearls of wisdom session. One last question actually from the audience, and forgive me, by the way, because I've been looking down and I've been not using my phone. I've actually been looking at the sheer weight of questions coming in. So clearly we haven't done a great job of answering everything because, there's plenty more running in. Olga, did you just put your hand up? Did you want to? Nope.
My light, sorry.
Okay, so next question is, there are a few which are sort of duplicating, so I'm not going to go through those clearly. So in terms of the a few questions are coming about the disclosures and the timeline. In fact, we've got about five questions about that. So really, Paul, for you, there's a real compression going on here with these deadlines. Can you just quickly talk about that?
Yeah, so that's the issue that the financial institutions or financial sector is struggling with. All of this has descended on the market quite rapidly, irrespective of the fact that it's been out there for 50 years, the requirements that they have to meet. And talking about data, they don't have the data. So setting up a whole data management frameworks is something that they have to address. So initially, the quality of the data is not going to be great, but eventually they will have set up all those frameworks. However, will that match the regulatory timelines? And that is what everyone, the financial sector, is struggling with at the moment.
Okay, this is for the audience's benefit. And this is very odd, by the way. I mean, I really don't like addressing my screen, and I can't wait to see all of you in person. And GT Grant Thornton will be organizing an event hopefully at the end of this year where we can all meet, and the same panelists are clearly invited. So let's go to the pearls of wisdom session. As I see people on their screens, Olga first, please.
Yes, just to sum up what I have said before, that please don't discount next generation from your investment advice and your investment horizons, because they will be the wealthiest generation, and they have to be well educated by independent advisors. Also, to reach the real impact, the strong engagement with the companies where you invest is recommended, or at least at the supervisory board level. And the last one is, do educate your clients, your investors, and let them know how you invest their money to reach the sustainable development goals, because they will be proud and they will invest even more.
Yeah, thank you. Angus?
Yeah, I think be on the front edge. Every minute and every dollar you invest in ESG within your firm, within your organization, will be well spent. Just to say that the road out there is rocky. We're at 417 ppm now. If we only got one part per million annually for the next 10 years, we'll obviously be through 427. The rainforest is forecast to halve in the next 30 years. So this is not a pleasant landscape. You have to be involved, but have your eyes wide open.
Thank you, Darshi.
Think of this as a step along the journey, not the end. So be open and collaborate.
Great, thank you. Ketan?
I'd say choose your fund manager well. If FMs were actually doctors, 8 out of 10 would be struck off. The industry is poor at delivering performance on an ESG. We are the 2 out of 10, and you'd expect me to say that. And we're here to deliver for clients who are serious about this. So get in touch with us, and we can show you how to be better at this. So you can go speak to my colleague, Phil Davey, and he'll, you know, set it up.
Great. Thank you, Paul.
Well, I think the typical thing is people tend to spend more time looking for schools for their children than they do in managing their life savings. So.
Indeed.
And that's a bit of a truism. So just echoing what everyone else has said, you really need to understand where your money is being invested. And if you want to have that green taint on your investments, then you really have to have an investment advisor that you really trust.
Yeah, no, well put. And Sandy, over to you.
No, thank you, Bobby. I mean, yeah, absolutely. I think it goes back to strategy. I think thinking right at the top, and I think getting all of the senior members to drive the right culture about this sort of thinking, and then really using the right components in the market. I think the market needs to shift. I think we need more players in what Catherine's been doing. And I think that kind of element, I think there's got to be a need. And I think the compression that COVID is bringing will mean there'll be an acceleration in this whole area. And from what we see is that a lot of clients need help to decipher what good looks like. And for their operating model, it can't be an overnight change. So different people, but as long as we put a program of change in play and are going in the right direction, that help for the broader community.
Great. Thank you all very much. Thank you to the audience. Thank you to the panelists. It's been a fantastic session. I feel like we've all learned an awful lot, and we look forward to another follow-up session, and we'll keep you posted, and enjoy the rest of the afternoon. And thank you to GT for organising this. Much appreciated.